personal responsibility on the road to restoration. And you know, one of the, when we sat down and we thought about this conference, wanting it to be as practical for you as possible, as helpful to you as possible, and we talked about taking common issues, common problems, like communication, very, very common difficulties with respect to marriage. Some of you newlyweds or you're engaged at the moment, you have no idea what we're talking about. You will, though. There will come a point where these things will need to be put into practice. Right now, you're in that honeymoon phase. However, these are very, very common problems in marriages and things that we run into all the time. You know, as I go through this particular session, if you've done any counseling with me with respect to marriage, you're probably going to think I'm talking about you. But I'm talking about all of our counseling. Every counseling session I've ever done has dealt with this particular issue, and I have to deal with this myself, so I have good material to draw from when putting the session together. These things are very common, including this particular issue that we'll get into. We live in a culture that is overtly offended by guilt or offended by shame. They have a conscience, a God-given conscience. We all do. And the culture in which we live, a cardinal sin is for someone else to draw attention to their guilty or accusing conscience. They're offended by guilt or shame. They would much rather silence their conscience and justify themselves by blame shifting, by playing the victim, by shoving off any personal responsibility for their actions, often by just being louder than the other guy, right? You see that on the news all the time, the way that people respond to this. It's seldom, if you notice, very seldom that we ever see someone take personal responsibility for their actions. It's uncommon. They'll say, I can't be the one to blame. You know, somebody or something else is responsible for my lot in life. I'm the victim of oppression as a black person, as a woman, as a homosexual, as a teenager, fill in the blank, right? And it's usually followed up by a sense of entitlement that someone owes me because I'm oppressed. I was reading this week, I came across an article on Brian Holloway. Have you ever heard that name before? Brian Holloway played for the Patriots, NFL superstar for the Patriots back in the day. And Brian Holloway owns two houses. I thought this was very interesting. Just it's goes right in line with what we're talking about. Brian Holloway has a home in Florida and has a home in Massachusetts. They were in their home in Florida when teenagers broke into their house. This was 2013, I think it was. Teenagers broke into his house in Massachusetts and held a huge blowout party. So they broke in. By the time it was all said and done, a very, very minimal estimate said the damages was well over $20,000. And these teenagers who broke into the house, had this party, were posting pictures of it, posting comments online. So Twitter and Facebook all abuzz with this party. And that's how Brian Holloway found out about it. He found out about it over Twitter, that somebody, that these kids had broken into his house and were having a party. So when he saw it online, he called the police. Police came out, and of course, kids, drunken kids, you know, in a stupor, scattered everywhere, driving home, that kind of thing. And so Brian said in the article that initially he was angry. And then that quickly turned to, we need to do something about these kids. These kids are ruining their lives and getting into all kinds of stuff they shouldn't be involved in. And so he set up a website called Help Me Save 300, I think is the name of the website, helpmesave300.com. So Brian put all those Twitter posts and Facebook posts on the website and posted them there. So kids taking pictures in his house on top of his tables or on his countertops and drinking and vandalizing his home. They were posting their pictures online. He took those pictures, posted them on the on his website, and gave them an option, these 300 kids or so. Said that they could take responsibility for their actions, come and help him clean up the mess. He had an event there the next weekend. Come help me clean up the mess, or you can not take responsibility. I'm going to press charges, and they're going to arrest you. And so he put that online, and the next weekend when they had the cleanup date, set, 4 kids showed up out of more than 300. Not only that, but there was a group, a fairly large group of parents who threatened to, and I think have sued, because he took their posts and put them on his website. So posted their pictures and essentially shamed them on his website. And now that's not going to hold up. Those are public. They posted them themselves. But that just goes to show you, right, the attitude, the heart attitude of people who want to shift responsibility. The very first time that I can recall that ever really taking place publicly, openly, was the McDonald's coffee suit. You remember that? A lady spilt her coffee in her lap after getting it through the drive-thru at McDonald's and sued McDonald's and won that lawsuit because the coffee, she said, was too hot. So just not willing to take responsibility for their actions. And the fact that those parents would not even take responsibility or insist upon their kids taking responsibility for their actions that night at that party, only 4 showed up, and then they even went so far as to threaten lawsuits against him. It was interesting to me this last week, I was listening to the news, and John Kelly, Trump cabinet member, the new Secretary for Homeland Security, actually came out on the news and took responsibility for the rollout of that executive order on immigration. Said that he confessed that he could have done a better job, that he didn't do what he needed to do to make that rollout more effective, more smooth. And I was shocked. I just don't remember the last time that I've heard a public figure like that come out publicly and accept responsibility for something that didn't go right. Just very rare that that happens. Sadly, this self-justifying, self-righteous, defensive response isn't just limited to special snowflakes on college campuses in safe zones, right? This kind of response we're all guilty of. This sin is very common, and we all do it. Even that guy. I love that picture because the look on his face, right? Very common, we all do it. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 says, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" It's deceitful above all things. So we think about those things like that story about the party at Brian Holloway's house is maddening. That would actually take place and the way those people respond. But we have to own up to the fact that we all justify ourselves to some degree or another. We are all prone to self-righteousness, to pride, to self-justification. It is a very, very common problem. Your biggest flatterer is the man in the mirror, right? It's a terrible problem. So, to prove my point, maybe you've used one of these self-justifying statements recently. See if any of these apply to you. So. Didn't get to take off the bottom little section there. You ever used that one before? You're react harshly, react rudely, but then you self-justify. We have a tendency to do that, don't we? We self-justify. I'm sorry, I'm just tired. No, you just sinned, right? What about this one? So... My brothers used that, so I felt comfortable using it. They joke about that all the time, so. All right, let's go to the next one. Right? That's a common one, isn't it? You just reacted angrily in the car. We all do this, don't we? In some form or fashion, often several times a day. What about the next one, brother? You ever use that one? Yeah, you're just complaining about the facts. That's what you're doing. You're complaining about the facts. What about the next one? You know, when someone asks you to help with the kids in the nursery. No. I'm really better suited for a teaching role. I'm gifted in other ways. You heard that one before? Right, maybe the last one? Yeah, you've heard that one before. Well, this next one is to the point. Right. We are so prone to do that all the time. It's very common, and we all do it, except me. Right? We'll just let the slides do the talking. Tried to imitate that guy. All right. It's particularly destructive, right, when we carry that kind of sinful baggage into our marriage, but we do. We are very prone, if not most prone, to have that kind of sinful interaction with our wife, with our husband, right? We self-justify, we're self-righteous. Self-righteousness is a marriage wrecker, is a relationship wrecker. And we'll talk about why that is as we go through. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. You can get my face off there, but you can go to the next one. I'm shamed enough. Thank you. All right, Matthew chapter 7. And I want you to take a look at this text. This text dealing with hypocritical judgment. We've looked at this text before, but I want to take a moment and apply it to what we're talking about and apply it to marriage in particular. All right, Matthew chapter 7. And look beginning at verse 1. Lord here in the Sermon on the Mount, teaching, and he says in verse 1, judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite. First remove the plank from your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Lord here in Matthew chapter 7 verses 1 through 5 is referring to the self-righteous judgment of the Pharisees predominantly. They, the Pharisees, being in the business of exalting themselves, were often guilty of mercilessly condemning others. That was their MO, right? This is very important to understand when it comes to taking personal responsibility or correcting patterns of self-justification, self-righteousness in your relationship. Success at justifying yourself most often comes at the expense of others. It's going to cost your spouse for you to justify yourself. Your self-justification comes at the expense of your spouse most often. Right, and for the Pharisees to get away with self-justifying or for exalting themselves, they had to diminish or to demean others. Those two things go hand in hand. So when you're self-justifying, it's often coming at the expense of your spouse. When you're married, this always tragically and destructively involves your spouse. When your self-righteousness runs amok, or you are self-justifying, your spouse is paying a price. Now let's consider this passage, Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5, in the context of a marriage relationship. And I want to look at three points, right? Responsibility disregarded, responsibility denied, and then responsibility demanded. I want to look at the text quickly and then apply this to marriage. Okay, so let's first look at responsibility disregarded in verse 1. The Lord says, verse 1, judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Now in verses 1 and 2, if you look at that text, the Lord reminds us that we ourselves are going to face judgment, right? While you may be judging someone else for their actions, you have to remember you are going to face judgment one day yourselves for your own actions. We're going to be held accountable for unjust or hypocritical judgments. James chapter 4, verse 11. Do not speak evil of or slander. Do not slander one another, brethren. He who speaks evil of a brother, and much more so your wife, right? Much more so your husband. He who speaks evil of a brother or wife or husband and judges his brother or wife or husband speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who are you to judge your spouse, judge another, judge a brother, right? Jesus says that God will judge using the same measure of judgment with which we judge others. And when we do that unjustly or hypocritically, When we presume to be judge over others, we'll take a look in a minute at what this looks like. But when we presume to be judge over others, we can't claim ignorance of God's standard. We, like Haman, right? We erect a gallows for our spouse, and we end up hanging ourselves on it. Does that make sense? So second point, beginning in verse 3, responsibility denied. Verse 3, the Lord says this, "Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye and do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me remove the speck from your eye,' and look, a plank is in your own eye?" The difference between the speck and the plank, right, makes the point that the sin of the self-justifying critic, right, the sin of the self-righteous spouse is greater than the sin of the other spouse. So when you stand in judgment, when you have a plank in your own eye, and you stand in hypocritical or unjust judgment of your spouse, and you don't take responsibility for your own sin, you don't take responsibility for your piece in all of this, then your hypocritical judgment, your self-justifying, is a greater sin. It's a plank when the other sin is compared to a speck. Does that make sense? That which blinds him to considering the plank in his own eye, verse 3, is his own self-righteousness. That was what the Pharisees were guilty of. His own self-righteousness, his own self-justifying conduct is that which blinds him to seeing the plank in his own eye. The plank of self-righteousness, the plank of his sin, is right there in his eye, and he can't see past it. If you've ever been involved, I have. I myself, to my shame, have been guilty of this. I've talked to brothers and sisters, many of you have too, that are guilty of this sin. You can't see past the speck in the other person's eye in order to see your own plank. Your self-justifying, self-righteous pride blinds you to the plank in your own eye. And so you become fixated, focused on the specks of your spouse. And it will wreck, destroy, run ramshod over your marriage if you keep doing that. It's a relationship killer. All he can do in this situation is see the sin of his brother, right? What the Lord is saying is consider your own sin. Consider your own sin, and then maybe you can help with your brother's sin, right? Third point, verse 5, responsibility demanded. The Lord says, hypocrite. He calls him a hypocrite. First, remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. You know, he puts on this critical, self-justifying, self-righteous, prideful spouse, puts on the mask of religious superiority, puts on a mask of right, puts on a mask of holiness. And that self-righteousness is blinding. You're blind to your own sin. You can't see clearly. You certainly can't see clearly enough to judge the matter from both perspectives rightly. You can't even see clearly to handle your own sin. Does that make sense? There is a necessity for righteous judgment. The Lord doesn't set aside righteous judgment here. He affirms it. But it's only when the plank is removed that you can then see clearly. All becomes clear, right? How's that plank removed? It's removed through humility. It's removed through genuine repentance. It's removed through dealing biblically with your sin and being in a state of humility before God that allows you to see clearly the situation that lies before you. An excellent illustration of this, right? If you take Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5, and you illustrate that in the Bible, excellent illustration is the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector in Luke 18. Listen to this parable. In light of those points, in light of what we just talked about, listen to the parable, verse 9. "Also, he spoke this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous, and they despised others." Now, think about that for a moment. Again, when you self-justify, when you're self-righteous in your relationship, that comes at the expense of your spouse. So you believe that you're righteous, and you show contempt, you show disdain, or you despise your spouse. "They trusted in themselves that they were righteous, and they despised others." Verse 10, "Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but he beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now, a lot of times we think about passages like that. We think about passages like Matthew chapter 7 in the context of salvation, someone coming to Christ. That has bearing in our relationship, doesn't it, with our spouse? You can see how someone in their relationship who does not take responsibility for their own sin, but justifies their sin or is self-righteous regarding their sin, how that is depicted in the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector in Luke 18. That's the picture. That's what you're doing in your marriage when you self-justify, when you don't take responsibility for your sin. In order to take personal responsibility for your sin in your marriage, it takes humility. It takes humility. You must be humble. That humility comes through conviction. Conviction over your sin, conviction of what the Word of God says, and then you need, with that conviction, with God's help, God's grace, you need courage to do what you need to do in your relationship, to restore your relationship. It takes humility, takes conviction, takes courage. All right. The point that I want to make clear this morning and have you consider with me is that this heart attitude, the heart attitude of the unjust judge in Matthew 7 and the attitude of the Pharisee in Luke 18 is prevalent in virtually every unresolved marital conflict. That attitude, that heart attitude, is prevalent in virtually every unresolved marital conflict. Maybe you've been there before, and you would think about that time right now that you're blaming your circumstances on your spouse. The circumstances have escalated, and they begin to grow, and they begin to get more and more out of control, to the point where your home now is no longer a peaceful, loving, kind, compassionate, loving, peaceful environment. It's now conflict. There's tension. Maybe you've gotten to the point before where you're strangers under the same roof. You're two ships passing in the night. You're not communicating like you once communicated. You're not affectionate like you were once affectionate. There's tension. In that kind of a situation, this is what's happening. It's prevalent in virtually every single one of those circumstances. Someone is being self-justifying. Someone is being self-righteous. Both are being self-justifying. Both are being self-righteous. Both letting their pride get the better of them, not repenting, not resolving the conflict. One or both spouses refusing to take personal responsibility for their sin, refusing to consider the plank in their own eye, and they're fixated on the speck in their spouse's eye. One or both poisoned with this self-justifying self-righteousness, right? Let me give you the deadly progression of that, how that looks in a relationship. Let me give you five steps of the deadly progression. This is the downward spiral. The first one is confrontation. Confrontation is simply dealing with sinful conduct. We do that in the church, right? Matthew chapter 18, other passages. You go to your brother, you go to your sister when they're in sin. You lovingly confront them in their sin between you and them alone, and you hope to restore fellowship with them when they repent of their sin and turn back to Christ, right? It's just loving confrontation. That's a good and biblical thing to do. You need to practice that in your relationship with your spouse, right? You're going to sin against your spouse. Your spouse is going to sin against you. And so when there's sin, you deal with that sin, and you deal with it on a behavioral level. It's the way the Lord deals with us, right? When the Lord deals with us, you sinned in this way. I'm going to call you to repentance for that sin, and we're going to restore the relationship. There's going to be forgiveness and peace again in our relationship. It's not that these things add up over time and then it becomes this huge unresolved mess of issues that now can't be resolved any longer because you're just so far gone and there's bitterness and anger and unforgiveness in the home, right? You deal with your spouse the way that God deals with you now. When you sin, you repent of your sin, you ask for forgiveness, you receive forgiveness, and you restore the relationship. Confrontation. Next level, though, when that doesn't take place the way that it's supposed to, it morphs into or evolves into criticism. Criticism is the next step. It may be in your relationship that you passed over confrontation altogether, and this is where you're at. You've had bad habits seep into your marriage, and so you're critical of each other now. You've sort of passed over the biblical confrontation step. You've not been dealing with sin biblically in your marriage, and so now you're at this step of criticism. Criticism is where death begins to seep into your relationship. This is sin. Rather than dealing with sinful behavior, now criticism begins to impugn their character. In other words, it goes from, what did you do? Well, let's deal with that what, and I want to repent of that what, and I want to forgive that what, and it moves to, you always do that, or you never do those things, because that's who you are. That's the way that you are. As long as I've known you, that's what you do. Do you see the difference between those two things? That's the way that the accuser of the brethren, right, whispers in the ear of the believer. That's not godly. It's not biblical. You go from dealing with sinful conduct to now impugning their character. Because you believe that to be a character flaw now, and your confrontation, you've skipped over confrontation, now you're dealing with criticism, you feel entitled to accuse them. You feel entitled maybe to punish them. Maybe to be rude back to them. Maybe you feel entitled to your anger, feel entitled to your bitterness. Remember that self-righteous people, self-justifying people, have to diminish others. So if you feel entitled to be angry with them, entitled to be bitter with them, entitled to maybe punish them with your words or with your actions, you are already the self-justifying, self-righteous Pharisee of Matthew chapter 7, Luke 18. It's already starting to seep in, right? This is where death creeps into your relationship. You're essentially now in the criticism phase. You're actually building a case against your spouse. You see that? Instead of just one event, and one event, and one event, and you keep clean accounts with God, clean accounts with your spouse, now it's you always or you never, and you're building a case. All these things are piled up. And you've got all this evidence. That's the way that you are. That's the way that I see you now. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, Paul says, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, all wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. After criticism comes contempt, which is a downward spiral. It's just a downward spiral, right? Contempt now manifests itself in purposeful actions or intentional words meant to hurt or wound or demean or diminish. So once you have camped out in the criticism phase for a short period of time, doesn't usually take very long. Now that criticism, and you always do this, you always do that, you never do this, turns into contempt. And you may not say it with your mouth, I love you, honey, but you're showing contempt for the other person in the way that you talk to them. Your words are hurtful. When things begin to escalate, you know exactly the right button to push, and so you push it. And it gives you joy to push it. You know, you like to put your finger right on that and see what happens, right? And escalate it even more. That's because you're already beyond criticism. Now you're in contempt. On the other person's part, here's where you'll see the eyes roll. You'll mention something and it'll be like, or like, what? You see the body language? The hostile body language, the eyes rolling. You'll get insults. You'll get sarcasm. Like biting sarcasm. You'll get harsh comments. You'll be mean to one another. mean-spirited, angry words. It's like you'll say things that you wouldn't say to anybody else, and you're saying them to your spouse. You're well down the spiral in contempt. The next is counterattack. Counterattack. You deny responsibility. It's not me, it's him. You fight back with accusations of your own. You accept no responsibility. All along, right? All along, as we get down this downward spiral of sin, you're self-justifying, you're self-righteous, you're taking no personal responsibility, you're lashing out at the other person now, right? So you're lashing out with accusations of your own. Not me. You know, it may show up like this, right? Listen, I know I'm not sinless in this, but that's the way it manifests itself. I'm not sinlessly perfect. I know I'm not the perfect husband. I'm not the perfect wife. But you always have to put your butt in there. Not me. It's you. It's that woman you gave me. Right. The last step is collapse. It's collapse. One or both shut down. Now there's no more listening. Everything is blocked off. Not even any more shallow attempts at effort. The effort just ceases. Now there's just resignation. Withdrawal. At this point, there's really no relationship left. You're living in an empty husk and ugly, right? Just no talking going on, no time together. You're strangers under the same roof. So think about that now. Confrontation, criticism, contempt, counterattack, collapse. The last step we'll talk about that in a few minutes, is correction. Is correction. How do you correct course and get back on track? First, though, what perpetuates that process? What perpetuates the process? Well, here's what does it. Your self-justification, your self-righteousness, your blame shifting, your failure to take personal responsibility for your sin. All of those begin with the word your, right? This is the reality of it. Now, in relationships, you do have circumstances where one person sins and the other person does not. You deal with that biblically. You deal with that biblically. When you don't deal with it biblically, you put yourself on this downward spiral. Then it becomes your responsibility to course correct, get yourself back on the right track. It is your self-righteousness. It is your self-justifying. It is your blame shifting. It's your failure to take personal responsibility that will push this thing from one level to the next. I've said it many times in counseling. It's really, really hard to argue with someone who won't argue with you. It's really difficult to get to contempt when this person simply will not do anything but exactly what the Lord would have him do in his circumstances. You maybe hold that person in contempt because he's doing that. You've got other problems if that's the case. But what perpetuates the process is your failure to deal with the plank in your own eye. And yes, by this point you have one. You've got one. Now, if you're thinking, you know, that's right. That's right. And my spouse needs to take responsibility for them. Well, we fight it all the time. But I venture to guess there are people in the room that may be thinking that right now. I hope she's listening to this. I hope he's listening to this. Take responsibility. Take responsibility. So let's talk about these individually, okay? First, self-justification. We'll do this quickly. Self-justification says, I did this because of the situation. I did this because of my circumstances. Here's how I acted. It's like, I forgot because I'm tired. Here's one thing I'll use to my shame. I forgot because I have so many other things on my mind. Self-justifying, right? Self-justification. We tend to do that for ourselves because we let ourselves off the hook. So we're quick to let ourselves off the hook, but we're quick to put our spouse on the hook. Blame shifting and self-righteousness sounds like this. They did that because that's who they are. They always do that. Blame shifting. She forgot because she's so selfish. You see? She forgot because she's selfish. That's who she is. That's blame shifting. That's self-righteousness. It's what we tend to do to others. We tend to self-justify But we tend to exercise self-righteousness in our interactions with other people. We don't critique or deal with their conduct. We impugn their character. We attack their character. This person is this way. She's always that way. Do you see? And remember, as you're doing that, you self-justify and at the same time tear her down, tear him down. Sometimes you self-justify by tearing her down or tearing him down. Self-justification, self-righteousness in your relationship comes at the expense of your spouse. It may sound like this: I know I could do better, but. I know I'm not sinless in this situation, but. I know I have my own weaknesses, but. Right? Self-justification. Self-justification. Self-righteousness, you don't know what it's like to live with him. You don't know what I'm going through. I'm not even sure that he's a Christian. Self-righteousness. The marriage is a wreck because my spouse is a wreck. I'm coming for help only because I want to fix the other person. I don't need fixing. I'm coming so that you will fix him, fix her. And when I address the one who presumes to think they don't need fixing, they get offended. They'll be out the door. What are you doing addressing me in this? It's him that's the problem. She's the problem, right? We want to fix the other person. She really needs to be confronted in her sin. I've gotten nowhere doing that. Somebody else really needs to confront him in their sin. You know, if she would just submit, right? If he would just lead, he doesn't lead. He doesn't lead our household. That's self-righteousness. It's blame shifting. Now, all that to say, there are pieces and elements. This is what makes this so insidious sometimes, is because there are elements of that which may be true. With self-justification, with self-righteousness, you don't believe that you're lying. You believe that you're telling the truth. You believe that you've got a good bead on the circumstances, that you understand the way things are going. You don't believe that you're making excuses. You're telling the truth as far as you're concerned. You don't believe that these are rationalizations. You don't believe that you're responsible for sin, or you don't believe that you're as responsible for sin as the other person. The other person obviously has the wrong perspective. And you believe your self-righteous self-justifications are true. You believe they're true. And they're blinding in that sense, right? They're blinding. You believe yourself to be right, and he is wrong. And because you're right and he is wrong, you're blinded to the plank in your own eye, and you simply won't see it. It's a vicious, insidious trap to be in, right? It's easy for us to see their sin, not as easy for us to see our own. And we tend to see ourselves as better than we are. Romans chapter 12, verse 3 applies here, I think. Paul says, "For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith." We tend to self-justify when it comes to our own sin, and that self-justification resolves it very quickly. We tend to fixate on the sins of our spouse, not willing to justify them. We're not willing to justify them. We tend to offload any conviction that we feel. We tend to offload it very quickly. But our fixation becomes making sure that our spouse feels conviction for not letting them off the hook. They can't get away with that. And making them feel their conviction as they should, right? That's our attitude. The problem is, too, that we believe we see things rationally, really as they are. And there's that element of truth that sort of anchors our self-justifying conduct. Now, unless you repent of this, you're going to ruin your marriage. You'll wreck your relationship. So you can't play the victim. You can't play the victim. In relationships where this begins to happen and you move beyond biblical confrontation, and now you're into sinful criticism. And maybe you've moved on to sinful, abhorrent contempt, right? You're moving down that spiral. You must repent. You must turn from your sin or you will ruin your relationship. Don't play the victim. Don't play the victim. You're not a victim. Take responsibility. You need to take responsibility. If you think that in all this is out of your control, right? This is the way that it is. I'm never going to change my wife, right? I'm never going to change my husband. If you resign yourself and concede in that kind of way, this is always going to be something that is done to you and not something that you have responsibility for to control and to fix. And God has given you a stewardship. If you're a husband, if you're a wife, God has given you a stewardship of your marriage relationship. So you've got to get in there and do what you need to do to fix your sin problem and work in your marriage. I was reading an article, we'll go over it in a second, by Doug Wilson, and Doug Wilson makes the point, he applies Peter's question about John. When Peter, he hears what he thinks the Lord's saying, that Peter or John is going to live, and Peter essentially asks the Lord about that, and so the Lord's response to Peter was, what is that to you? What is that to you, what happens to him? You follow me, right? That applies here. So if your spouse sins in this way or that way, you deal with the sin biblically, you deal with the sin biblically. But at the end of the day, what is that to you? You have responsibility in your marriage to fix this self-justifying, self-righteous conduct and to repent of your sin. Don't play the victim. This is not something that's just merely happening to you. You have responsibility for it. Let me give you some examples of that. Here's one. Your wife expresses to you that she feels neglected. She should, if she feels that way, right? Your wife expresses to you that she feels neglected. Rather than just confessing that you're in sin and repenting and bearing fruits of repentance and not neglecting your wife, you think of yourself as a good husband. I'm a pretty good husband. I love her. I love her. I do a lot of things for her that she doesn't acknowledge. She needs to stop complaining, right? But you have set aside very little time devoted to her. No substantial investment in building companionship with her. And that's the reality. Now, you can either, understanding that reality, you can do one of two things. You can say, one, listen, I'm busy. I have stuff going on all the time. I need time every now and then just to catch my breath, right? 2 hours of video games, a two-hour movie, 2 hours at fellowship, 2 hours, right? 2 hours of overtime. Besides, we just spent time together the other night watching a two-hour movie. That doesn't count. Back-to-back episodes of CSI. We sat there like zombies on the couch. You can do that, or number two, which takes humility and takes courage, you can repent of your neglect. You can ask your wife for forgiveness, right? And you can lead in the management of your home and spend the time that you need to spend, right? That's one example. Let me give you another. You know, that you're not being submissive to your husband in that particular area. You know it. Rather than just confessing that you're in sin, rather than just repenting and bearing fruits of repentance, you think to yourself, I'm a submissive wife. I submit to him in most areas. I'm not a perfect wife, but I'm a submissive wife. Trust me, I feel like I am submitting all the time. If somebody could see the bite marks on my tongue, he's being unreasonable in this. But you know, you have failed to lovingly follow your husband's lead when it comes to the kids, when it comes to the home, when it comes to church, when it comes to whatever it is, right? Whatever it is. You have failed, and you know it, you have failed to submit to your husband in that particular area. You can do one of two things. You can either say to yourself, what he wants in this is not going to make a difference. Not going to make a difference. Besides, I don't trust his leadership. He's just trying to control my life. I don't get any say in this. Right? When did we ever talk about this? You can accuse your husband. He's just bringing this up because I told him I feel neglected. So now he brings this up. You're not being submissive to me in this area. This is what he always does. This is what he always does. He provoked me. He provoked me. Or, you can repent of your rebellion against God. You can ask for your forgiveness. You can trust the Lord and submit to your husband, right? You have those choices laid out before you. What are you going to do? That's the issue. It's one humble, repentant, loving, what God intends. The other, rebellious, self-justifying, self-righteous, prideful, relationship crushing, right? Love squashing. You've got a choice. You got water in your hand and gasoline. What are you going to put on the fire, right? Humility, takes conviction, takes courage. The last step in the process, think about the C's there, is correct, correction. Correction, you must see it rightly. I read an article, this comes from Douglas Wilson, and I have thought about this in, you know, numerous counseling appointments, trying to communicate this, and I just, when I read this article from Douglas Wilson, just couldn't think of communicating it any better. It just really helped sort of lock it down in my mind. Most people think of, he calls it that counseling or marriage relationship is not a zero-sum game. In other words, there's not one pie that equals 100%. You guys can really see that well over there, can't you? And when you come in or when you're sitting down, you're working through the problem, you're divvying up that particular pie with your own percentage of responsibility, right? That here's my responsibility. And here's my spouse's responsibility, right? So I have 1%, but it's all her. So you sit down and you think about your relationship that way, that you want to divvy up responsibility for the sin that is harming your relationship. The reality is that you have two circles. And here's the more biblical way to think about this. You have 100% responsibility for your sin in the relationship, for your self-justifying, for your self-righteousness, for your pride, for your sin, for your actions. And you're 100% responsible for dealing with that sin. And if you don't, you're crushing, you're killing your relationship. Your spouse, they have their own 100% responsibility for their own sin. You're like, yeah, that's right. That thing is, let me tell you what's in there. You're missing the point again. You're just messing up all the time. Focus on your 100%. You have 100%. It was so, when are we going to get to her 100%? Counseling over. We just can't. We're not getting anywhere, right? You got to focus on your 100%. A good illustration, I think it's a good illustration that helps think about that is I use the Orlando nightclub shooting, right? You have this wicked guy. Oh, thank you, brother. This wicked guy that goes into a nightclub, homosexual nightclub in Orlando, and shoots those 49, kills 49 people, right? Terrible tragedy. That wicked guy, 100% responsible for that heinous act. He goes in there and shoots those people, just a deplorable, disgusting, wicked, horrendous act. He's 100% responsible for that. Now, you say things like this, and you can get yourself in hot water with people that have self-justifying sensibilities, but those people who were in that club are 100% responsible for their part in all of that too. It doesn't diminish his heinous act, doesn't diminish his wickedness. It is horrendous what he did, horrendous. But they weren't there glorifying God. They weren't, you know, at home doing something. They chose to go there. You know, how many news stories do you have to see where a young girl goes into a bar dressed in next to nothing, flirtatious, sits down at a bar, guy comes, drops something in her drink, and she is found dead behind a dumpster the next day, right? How many of those stories do you have to see? And listen, the one who did that, wicked, deplorable, heinous offense against God. Like, just, it can't be overstated how wicked that act is. But that girl went into that bar. She sat there maybe next to a guy she had no business sitting next to, wearing something she had no business wearing. She has her own circle, do you see? Not to diminish his horrendous act at all, not to diminish Omar Mateen's horrendous act at all, but taking personal responsibility for their own part in the sin. In your relationship, you have to do the same thing. You have to take your fixation off your spouse's 100%, and you have to be fixated on your own sin, on your own sin, on what you have done. You need to repent of your sin. You need to humble yourself and ask your wife, ask your husband for forgiveness. Focus on your plank, the plank in your eye, right? Let me give you a couple of steps. The first is to acknowledge that. If you are having difficulties in your relationship and those difficulties have not been consistently resolved such that you have completely clear accounts with your husband, completely clear accounts with your wife, and completely clear accounts with God, then you need to work on that today. Take responsibility for your plank, repent of your sin, do that now, and turn to Christ, turn to your husband, turn to your wife, ask for forgiveness, get that done immediately. Clear those accounts. And that can be done, like I know, when we talk about counseling or we're dealing with circumstances, a lot of those things are deep set over years and years of time. You right now have this tangled, I love my brother's analogy of the fishing line, you know, this tangled wad of fishing line. You don't think you can do anything with it? God can. And it begins with your repentance. And in the same way that your whole tangled web in life, that whole clump that you were before Christ, how Christ just, you can do that too in Christ for your husband, for your wife. You need to do that. You need to ask your spouse for forgiveness. You need to have clear accounts. And then you need to deal with your sin in the relationship, whatever it is. And humble yourself to ask your spouse about it. Get feedback on that. Keep clean accounts, clear accounts with your spouse and with God. Next thing you need to do, we've talked about this before, I know, is cultivate companionship. Cultivate companionship. These resolutions and this process doesn't work if you're not spending quality time with together. And that's, my brother pointed that out in his session this morning. You need to spend time together, and that's non-negotiable. So you need to connect in the morning before you split and go your separate ways to work or wherever. Just sit and spend a few minutes talking. It could be over the breakfast table. It doesn't take long to do that. You need to connect when you reunite at the end of the day, right? When you come back from work, you come back from school or wherever, and you talk, you spend, how was your day? And you spend some time deliberately talking and interacting with one another. Make that a non-negotiable. Have a weekly date. Just make it a non-negotiable. Spend time. And that doesn't mean back-to-back episodes of CSI on the couch like zombies. You can't do that then. You know, a movie can't satisfy that, right? Movies are very, I love going to a movie with my wife, right? But that movie time can't satisfy that necessity. You just can't talk through a movie like that. Sometimes my wife tries, but we can't talk right now, sweetie. We're in a movie theater. So So you've got to have time. Yes. So you've got to have time together to talk. And make that a non, it's got to be a non-negotiable. What you're doing is you're cultivating companionship. Cultivating companionship. You need to cultivate companionship. Part of that is intimacy. My brother also pointed that out this morning, intimacy. You know, you could say, my husband doesn't need that. You know, my wife, she doesn't need it. Paul says, let the husband render to his wife the affection due her. Likewise also the wife to her husband. She may, he may say, it's not important, or he doesn't need that. He needs it. You know, he needs it because the Bible says he does, and God's always true, and every man is a liar. So render the affection due her. Render the affection due him. Don't sin in that way against your spouse. Cultivate companionship. Cultivate affection. Cultivate affection. If you're not holding hands, if you're not sitting on the couch with your arm around your wife, if you're not affectionate with one another, there's just that cultivates distance. It doesn't cultivate companionship. It cultivates distance. Be affectionate with one another. If you're not affectionate, then repent of not being affectionate. Render the affection due her. Render the affection due him. That's a command from Paul in 1 Corinthians 7. The other thing is you want to do is you want to cultivate common basis. Cultivate common basis. And that means Christ. The thing that you have in common that is most cherished between the two of you, your common interest. And for Christians, that's Christ, right? Should be serving in the church, serving the Lord by serving your brothers and sisters. You want to do that through family devotions, just reading the Bible together, talking about the Bible together, talking about what you're reading, what you're learning, just talking, spending time. What you're doing is you're cultivating common basis. You're cultivating Christ in common. And that's important. You're cultivating companionship. You're cultivating Christ in common. And just render both of those things non-negotiables. When you do that, then when issues come up, when things come up, you can deal with them biblically, right? Honey, you've heard the old sort of axiom that you have to put in a bunch of deposits before you make a withdrawal, right? Talking about encouragement and, you know, communication, those kinds of things. Okay, well, cultivate companionship in your relationship and these conversations such that you're making a lot of deposits all the time. I love you. I love how you handle this. I love the way that you do that with the kids. I'm so grateful for the way that you keep our house. Or, you know, all those kinds of things. You just cultivate that kind of companionship such that when the time comes and something happens, and it will, you can say, honey, I need to talk with you. You know, I love you and I'm so grateful to God for you. This has been on my mind and we really need to deal with this. Can we talk for a moment about that, right? And you just biblically deal with that particular thing without it escalating, without the hot button level at contempt or level at criticism or level at collapse, without having to deal with it in that kind of environment. You're dealing with it all the way back up at biblical, loving, compassionate confrontation. And you just deal with it right then. Honey, please forgive me. I forgive you. And it's done, right? Beautiful. And then you keep clean accounts with your spouse, clean accounts before God. And that's the way that you keep a blessed relationship before God. Amen? All right, let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for these biblical principles that are so clear in your word to help us wisely navigate the challenges of marriage. They're challenges because of our flesh. Because we are, Lord, so prone to self-justifying, self-righteous, prideful conduct. We don't see our sin, and we try to let ourselves off the hook. And it happens so consistently, it becomes sometimes almost habitual, and our hearts are deceitful, desperately wicked, and all these things are arrayed, it seems, against us, and so we sin. We're going to sin against you. We sin against our spouse. But I pray, Lord, that you would help us. Spirit of God, help us to be humble when we do. Help us to acknowledge our sin. Help us to have the conviction, the strength that your Spirit supplies to go and to ask for forgiveness and to resolve those things with our spouse quickly such that it doesn't just continue to spiral downward through criticism and contempt and Help us, Lord. Help us to see it. Protect us, Lord, from just always being blinded by our own self-righteousness, blinded by our own self-justifying conduct, and blinded to our own sin because we have our eyes wide open and fixated on our spouse's sin. Lord, help us to accept responsibility for our 100% and to faithfully follow you in that, and to repent of sin and to clear accounts and to live with a clear conscience before you, Lord, which is such a blessed thing. And Lord, help us to cultivate companionship with our spouse. Help us to cultivate Christ in common. Lord, we want to serve you in these ways. We want to honor you in these ways. And we know, Lord, that when we do that, then our relationships are blessed and we experience the blessing that you intend marriage to be. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for your forgiveness that's available in Christ. Thank you for hope of blissful marital relationships, Lord. And I pray that you'd allow us, Lord, to walk in that kind of marital bliss for my brothers and sisters here, for my wife and I, knowing, Lord, that that's most honoring to you. We love you, Lord, and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.